Hello friends, we know that domain-driven design has become very popular due to microservices and cloud computing. So let's get prepared for domain-driven design together. My name is Vikas. I have more than 20 years of experience in IT industry. I have worked on domain-driven systems, and recently I'm working on enterprise domain-driven system for 6 months. So what is the best way to brush up your domain-driven design? Why not go through the interview questions and see what are they asking and what are they answering? So I Googled and found out the first 35 domain-driven design interview questions. So we're going to read the questions, read the answer, review the answers, how I would have answered these questions. So if you are getting ready for domain-driven design, you are preparing for interview, or you want to curious, we're going to go through domain-driven design in details. So first question is, how would you describe what is domain-driven design from developer point of view? I think from developer point of view, it is a pain, a lot of extra work, complexity. I'm just joking. So if somebody would have asked me, what is domain-driven design? My answer is, it is about using a shared language, common language between domain experts and programmers. Let's see what does he answer. He says domain-driven design is a methodology and process prescription for the development of a complex system whose focus is on mapping activity, tasks, data within a problem domain into technical artifacts of a solution domain. That's a nice example. The emphasis of domain-driven design is to understand the problem domain in order to create an abstract model of the problem domain, which can then be implemented in a particular set of technologies. Domain-driven design as a methodology provides guidelines how this model development and technology development can result in a system that meets the needs of the people using it, while also robust in the face of change of problem domain. I think the next line is very important. The process side of the domain-driven design involves a collaboration between domain experts and the programmer. This is what domain-driven design is. It is about using the common language. Suppose you are building some software for a banking system. You need to understand the banking system and your model, system model. Your classes should represent the entities in the domain, events in the domain. There is a customer in banking industry. He withdraws money. That's an event. That's how your object classes should be named. And that's the name of method should be, event should be. So if you give this example, generally it's great. But if you can remember, I really liked, it's a methodology and process prescription for the development of complex system, which focuses on mapping activity, tasks, events, and data within a problem domain into technical artifacts of a solution domain. If you can memorize, awesome. Main thing is, it's about having a ubiquitous language. It is having one common language between domain experts and programmers. It's focusing on the domain layer. So next question is, list some advantages of domain-driven design, why developers should use it. And he put it very nicely. First thing is ubiquitous language, one common language between developers and domain experts. And that's what, like, most of the problems happens in the software industry due to miscommunication between developers and business community. And this, using domain language, common languages, solves this problem. And a lot of time, what is domain layer? It's a business layer. So if you have been into object-oriented programming for some time, here you can list the benefits of object-oriented programming. It makes maintenance easier. Your presentation logic is different. Your persistence logic is in different layer. Presentation layer changes, persistence layer changes, domain layer generally stays the same. So it's very important layer. You can write tests about this layer. And that's what third point he's talking. The domain is more important than the interfaces, then the UX and the backend, because domain layer will decide whether your project is success or fail. Third question is interesting. What are the fundamental components of domain-driven design? So one language again comes first. So always remember, one language, domain-driven design is one language between domain experts and programmers. Then it talks about, as I talked, it's object-oriented programming. When you have object-oriented programming, you will have multi-layered architecture. So generally in this, you have presentation layer, application layer, domain layer, infrastructure layer. Presentation layer is your presentation. It could be Angular, React. Application layer is about, it's kind of controller in MVC. So you manipulate domain objects to do some services for you. And that's what happens in the application layer. It should be very, very thin. And fundamental, a lot of these concepts are used in domain-driven design or in any multi-layer object-oriented design, and data access objects, interfaces, factories. Factories are used to create classes so that you don't have to create classes themselves. This way you create a light coupling between system and the classes. You can replace the classes with better implementation. Repositories is about abstracting your data persistence. You don't care where the object is coming, which database, is it SQL, Oracle. You go to repository and get your object, modify it, delete it, perform your CRUD operations. Facade. Facade is kind of factory design pattern. It's about hiding the complexity. Like application layer is a facade example. It's hiding the complexity, how domain layer objects works together to get some services done. Data transfer objects, they transfer data from one layer to another layer. Unit test, domain-driven design generally means you have a domain layer, you can write unit tests. Generally, writing tests for presentation layer is difficult. So question four is, what is domain model in domain-driven design? Let's see what he says. The domain model is a software model of very specific business domain you are working. So if you are working for banking system, your domain model is the banking system. Often it's implemented as object model. So for bank, you will have a class. For money, you may have a class. And these objects have both data and behavior. You have a bank account, somebody deposit money, somebody withdraws money. These are behavior. And you have a money, that is data. So creating a unique, carefully crafted domain model is at heart of the core strategic application or subsystem essential in practicing domain-driven design. With domain-driven design, your domain models will tend to be smallish, very focused. Use domain-driven design. You never try to model the whole enterprise with a single large domain model. I'll come into later. We'll be talking about bounded contest. I have made 3 times video on bounded contest. A lot of people again ask, what is bounded contest? Today, again, we'll try to answer that question. So question 5 is, what is specification in domain-driven design? A specification represents a business rule that needs to be specified by at least part of the domain model. Cool. What is the distinction between value type and entity types in domain-driven design? So entity types are nothing, something which you need to persist in database. They have some unique identification. Your customer in a bank, he has a customer ID. Where are value types are immutable. The big example of value type is color. You want red color. You don't care what is the ID of that color. If that red color goes bad, you replace with another one without caring about their unique ID. All what you want to do is something get done by them. So those are called value types. Question 7, what is event sourcing pattern? Event sourcing pattern is very interesting in cloud computing. In event sourcing pattern, you never destroy the data. You are always adding the new data. Suppose somebody updates the data. you keep the original record and you add another record with modified data. If somebody deletes, you don't physically delete, you soft delete. The benefit of in cloud computing is there's the audit. It's million of events will happen and something goes wrong, you don't want to start it again. So this event log gives you capability that you can rerun the process because you know the operations, what operations were done. So you can run your system from any point of failure. This is interesting. He says CQRS. We'll discuss CQRS a little bit later. CQRS may use event sourcing, but not necessarily. Explain the concept of repository in the context of domain-driven design. He says a repository represents all objects of a type as a conceptual set. It acts as like a collection, except with more elaborate querying ability. Objects of the appropriate types are added and removed, and the machinery behind the repository inserts them or deletes them in the database. I would just say repository is a pattern by which you abstract your persistence layer. You implement repository pattern and you don't care what is back end, like is it a database or message queue, is it Oracle database or SQL Server database. So next question is interesting. What are the different layers in domain-driven design? Already we discussed, okay, there is a user interface, this is a application layer, domain layer, and infrastructure layer. So application layer you use to make sure that domain objects coordinate together, you perform some kind of choreography, orchestration inside of application layer to get some job done by the domain. So you need to do some transaction, you need a bank clerk, he may audit your transaction and then transaction happens. So there are different actors, different events that need to be coordinated. And one interesting thing is infrastructure. Infrastructure is managing your persistence layer, also access to other layers. And you can see application layer can connect to the infrastructure because it may be calling some authentication from third party authentication services. In microservices architecture, it's very common to call other microservices. Mention how you can give unique objects a unique ID in domain-driven design. So either you can give a GUID as a unified number, or generally in the database, it's a primary key, it is a auto increment number in SQL Server, that's how you give the unique. So name some benefits of CQRS benefit. In CQRS, command query, responsibility, segregation pattern, you make sure the components who are reading are separate. The components who are writing to the database are separate. That way, you can coordinate the databases which are doing read. You can optimize those databases for the read operations. They may have a lot of indexes. Whereas databases which are performing transaction, they may have less indexes and they will perform this transaction fast. So here comes bounded context. Remember, we said before, you never have a unified domain model at the enterprise level. Because people found out if you try to implement domain model at the enterprise level, it is very, very difficult. So you define bounded context. This is sales is a bounded context. Support context is another bounded context. Then by the customer, for the sales could be different. It could be end customer. Whereas for the support, the customer could be people from other department. So it's very difficult to have a unified model. So what you do is you create bounded context and you define domain-driven model within that context, and that's it. What it means to focus on problem space rather than a solution space? Looks like to me it's saying that understand the domain model than your technical solution. What is domain in domain-driven design? So that's an interesting question, like what is domain in domain-driven design? That's everything. So you can give a banking answer that in the banking, their business is banking, that is banking is the domain. So let's see what he says. In order to create good software, you have to know what that software is all about. You cannot create a banking system unless you have a good understanding of what banking is all about. One must understand the domain of banking. Domain is a field in which system is built. Airport management, all those, you name it. It's not unusual for an application to span different domains. So in enterprise, you can have different domains. So what is event storming in domain-driven design? I heard this term first time here. It's an interactive team practice based on sticky notes put on a board and rearranged and the modeling process. It starts with the identification of events, seeks the commands that cause them, and looks at the involved aggregate entities. It engages both domain experts and developers in a fast-paced learning process. The out-of-event storming describes the domain using the DD concepts. Domain concepts, commands, aggregates, issues, user roles, viewer. So looks like to me it's a way of understanding the domain model where you are coming up the understanding the domain. This looks like what is model in domain-driven design. So a model is a useful approximation of the problem at the hand. So looks to me it's your diagrams and which represent the problem. So it's never accurate, it's exact. So question 7 is, what is the command query segregation pattern? Seems like repeating. So what is the difference between data transfer objects and view models? As I discussed before, data transfer objects are used to transfer data from one layer to another, whereas view models are objects which present data to the view. Why you need to have view model? How you represent the data may be different than your business object. You may be showing data different for mobile, different for websites. So you don't want to distort or mess up your business object, your model. You come up with view model. So what is the difference between behavior-driven development versus domain-driven design? Domain-driven design, we can again say, support one languages, identifying actors, entity, operation, understanding. Behavior-driven design is focused on defining user stories and scenarios. Question 20, what is the difference between domain objects, POCO, services? It could be Java, C# objects. So it has no logic. It would not have any data persistence. It just stores data in the memory. Domain object is an instance of the class that represents some and concepts in your domain. Model object, I think it's same as domain model. Entity, as discussed, is a some class which need persistence in the database. It need to be uniquely identified. A person, I myself, it need to be identified. Repository, already we discussed, repository is about abstracting the database layer. And services are classes which give some services. You need to perform some operation on your bank. So you can have a banking service which does for you. So thanks friend for watching this video. We will go through more questions later. So if you like this video, like it, share it, and subscribe to my channel for your regular updates. Connect with me on LinkedIn and Twitter, especially LinkedIn if you like small summaries of the video. I will be posting a lot of small summaries of the video on LinkedIn. Thanks, friend.